Good afternoon. A sous-chef has been charged with murder after allegedly stabbing his female co-worker to death at Canberra's National Zoo. Police are still trying to work out if the two were anything more than colleagues. Annie Puller reports.
Good afternoon. 29-year-old Jude Wijesinghe was working inside a commercial kitchen at Canberra Zoo's Wildlife Lodge when police say he killed a female kitchen hand who had only recently moved here from Bhutan. 7 News understands the woman's body was found by staff who heard her screams. The sous chef tried to take his own life but survived serious injuries. He has since undergone surgery in hospital and is due to face court next year, charged with murder. The woman's death has shocked staff at this popular tourist site, which is usually overrun with families during the school holidays. Today, dozens of visitors were turned away as a homicide investigation commenced behind closed gates.
That's really a heartbreaking thing. Like, that's really sad.
We are quite excited to be here at the zoo, but having heard that news now, it's really disheartening.
Police are still trying to work out if the pair shared a relationship outside of work or if this was a random attack. Jude Wijesinghe's vehicle has been towed and his apartment searched by forensic officers. Trauma counselling is now being offered to staff, many of whom have told 7 News they're shocked and devastated something so horrific could take place at a popular tourist site.
One of Australia's most notorious convicted terrorists is today a free man. Abdul Ben Bricker, who plotted to blow up multiple Australian landmarks, was released from prison this morning under an extended supervision order. Emma O'Sullivan has the latest.
That's right, and it's the first time Abdul Nasser Ben Bricker will be living in the community since his arrest almost 20 years ago. It was a jury that found him guilty of directing a homegrown terror cell that had discussed potential plots against landmarks in Melbourne and Sydney. He was sentenced to 15 years behind bars that expired in November 2020. Since then, he's been subject to continued detention orders to keep him behind bars. He was for a time stripped of his Australian citizenship, but he successfully challenged that move in the High Court. So the Attorney General and Ben Bricker's lawyers had agreed that today he would be released on an extended supervision order, but there was a dispute over some of the conditions. For instance, the government wanted it to run for 3 years. The Supreme Court has just announced a one-year order, the judge citing evidence from an international terror expert who assessed Ben Bricker's risk of reoffending as low.
Anthony Albanese's Christmas present to the Australian people is to let our most notorious terrorist out.
It's a matter of the law, and we have put in place the strongest possible recommendations to ensure community safety.
So he'll be subject to 30 conditions. He has to abide by a curfew, he'll live with his wife and family, and he has to continue his participation in de-radicalisation programs. He's due to be released from Victoria's Barwon prison this afternoon.
Westpac is back online after customers were hit by an hours-long outage this morning. Mobile, telephone and online banking services were disrupted shortly before 10:30 a.m, also affecting St George customers. Westpac has apologised and says customers may still run into intermittent issues. A little more than a week after Anastasia Palaszczuk quit, another interstate leader has stepped down. Northern Territory Chief Minister Natasha Files has resigned over undisclosed shares in a company which owns a mine. There had been calls for testing on the mine's health impacts. The rain is subsiding and rivers across far north Queensland are falling, but the region remains a disaster zone. Evacuations are continuing, many communities remain cut off, and some are running out of essentials. Christina Puljak reports.
The rain has stopped and the skies, at least here in Cairns, are beginning to clear as disaster response really begins to ramp up. One major effort today is to completely evacuate the small community of Woodjewoodjew after heavy rain frustrated efforts yesterday. The Australian Defence Force is using helicopters to ferry the 300 odd people there north to Cooktown.
At the moment we're forecasting that we can evacuate up to 120 people today, and depending on their desire for further evacuations we should be able to support into tomorrow.
In the Dane Tree, flood warnings remain in place with communities still cut off.
We have over 32 communities, small locations of small number of houses or properties that we need to access today.
The tourist town of Port Douglas, north of here, has been running out of essentials. 500 personnel are being deployed to the worst hit areas on the Cassowary coast. There are concerns across the region about access to clean drinking water. People are being warned supplies could remain critically low all week and being encouraged to buy bottled water. In Tully, residents are being advised to boil their water as supplies may be contaminated. And Cairns Airport reopened this morning with the first services reserved for emergency use.
I think that all of the agencies have, whether they're federal or state, have done a remarkable job under what are difficult, unprecedented circumstances.
Meanwhile, police say there are concerns for an 85-year-old man that has gone missing from Djara east of Wujul Wujul. Nobody has seen the man since Sunday.
After years of promises, the people of Penrith finally have a beach to help beat the summer heat. Jodie Lee has more from Western Sydney.
Good afternoon. Well, they're calling this Pondi. Penrith Beach is the same length as Bondi, but critically, it's here in Penrith in the heart of Western Sydney, where temperatures regularly soar and the drive to the coast can be over an hour long.
Really exciting. It's only 5 minutes down the road from home, so it's so much easier to pack up the three kids, get in the car and come straight down the road.
It is nice. It's supposed to be like really hot today. It might get really hot, so the water might be really cool.
This body of water has been here for years, but it was never open to the public. The Minns government spent $1.7 million to bring it up to standard and get the beach ready in time for this summer. The beach can accommodate thousands of people at any one time. There are toilets and change rooms and even a kiosk. It is free of charge to visit, but access here can be tricky. You can't walk or cycle to the water. The only way in is by car or shuttle bus.
I'm expecting there will be thousands of people here at any one time. Of course, the capacity of the car park is 700 cars at once. People will also be able to come to be dropped off as well as on the shuttle bus.
This summer will serve as a bit of a test case. If the beach proves popular with locals, it could be expanded to include permanent infrastructure to rival Sydney's natural beaches.
Amber Laidler joins us now with the latest on Sydney's weather. Amber, it is smoky across the city today.
Good afternoon, Angie. Yes, we've seen that blanket of smoke settling over Greater Sydney and the Hunter region today. The source is a large out-of-control bushfire burning just south of Narrabri in northern New South Wales. It's already burnt through more than 112,000 hectares. At one point, it produced its own thunderstorm, but it has been downgraded to a Watch and Act alert level this afternoon. Northerly winds are pushing that smoke down into Sydney, with some satellite imagery showing it stretching across the Tasman, though a southerly change should flush that smoke out of Sydney this evening. That change also means tonight should be a bit more comfortable after the city sweltered through above average temperatures overnight and throughout today, reaching 34 to 35 degrees across much of the city. We are also keeping an eye on multiple storm warnings in place across the state this afternoon. One cell is tracking down into the central coast. 1.5 centimetre hail has been reported at Clarencetown, just north of Maitland. We'll have more details in the full forecast a little bit later, Angie.
Thanks, Amber. See you soon.